Grant, O Lord, that we may always revere and love your holy name, for you never deprive of your guidance those you set firm on the foundation of your love. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. I'd like to call our children and facilitators to come forward at this time. Lord, you receive this word of God, take it with you, proclaim it, share it with these young lives, help them to become comfortable and confident, living on to a God who loves us in all things. In your hands today is entrusted with the mighty word. Go with the peace of Christ.
Speak the word of this day. Let your word down deep in me. Speak the word of this day.
And they shall look on him who they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only son, and they shall grieve over him as one grieves over a firstborn. On that day, the mourning in Jerusalem shall be as great as the mourning of Hadad-Rimmon in the plain of Megiddo. On that day there shall be opened to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem a fountain to purify from sin and uncleanness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yes.
reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. Brothers and sisters, through faith, you are all children of God in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free person. There is not male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's descendant, heirs according to the promise. The word of the Lord.
John the Baptist, others, Elijah, still others, one of the ancient prophets has arisen. Then he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Peter said in reply, the Christ of God. He rebuked them and directed them not to tell this to anyone. He said, the Son of Man must suffer greatly and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Then he said to all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. The Gospel of the Lord.
The gospel that we continue to answer all of our lives, who Jesus is to us. You know, and I think that the unique thing about this whole picture in the scriptures is that it was after Jesus had prayed, after he had stopped and thought about it, and said, okay, to kind of test the waters. I mean, let me see where these disciples are at. And so, who did they say I am? And, you know, and you heard it as well as I did. Well, John the Baptist, or one of the prophets, or Elijah. You know, and he said, well, who do you? And Peter, the first one to speak up, said, you're the Messiah, Son of God. I said, well, you're right, but don't tell anybody, because there's still things that have to happen. There's still things that have to happen so that you will really know. It's kind of like a classroom setting. I mean, sometimes we get in a classroom setting, we know the right answer, but those of us who have had some experience in life realize that there is more to life than the right answer. There's more to life than just knowing the answer. It's being able to live out life itself. And that's what Jesus was asking his disciples. Give me time to be amongst the people so that they will come to have a better understanding of who I am. I'm not here just to save, you know, what's going on. You know, to save them from the Roman Empire, to restore the Jewish religion, to bring back Jerusalem. He was to save them for what will be for eternity. And in order to do that, they needed not to know just the right answer, but to have it sink into the fiber of their being. He needed the people to know that this Jesus of Nazareth was really the Savior of the world and not the restorer of a local government. All of us have to learn that same kind of process in our life. Jesus isn't just the one that helps us pass this test or gets us into our college or lets us have this job. Jesus is the one that we develop a relationship that gives us the kingdom of God. And Jesus constantly proclaimed that the kingdom is at hand. It's here and right now. We don't have to be pronounced physically dead by a coroner to be able to enter into the kingdom of God. It is here. But what we have to do is to die to ourselves, just like Jesus died. We have to be able to die to ourselves, and the way we do that is through love. So it's not that we're going to be nailed to a cross when we're said we've got to pick up our crosses and follow Jesus. What we have to do is to follow his teaching of knowing that our responsibility is to love God and to love one another. And in order for us to love one another, it means that we've got to die to our own pride and our own ego and our own way. I mean, granted, everybody has this first infatuation with love. You know, oh, I love this movie, or I love this person, or I love this game, or I love this place. You know, but that all, that's short-lived. Marriages have the infatuation. Priesthood has the infatuation. Everything has this infatuation, but it's all short-lived because there's always challenges and unexpected things that happen that really take you down to the bottom of your toes to say, do I really believe this? Am I really willing to resist for this? And we've got to die to ourselves so that we can follow Jesus. That's the challenge of the scripture. Jesus wanted to, okay, I've chosen these 12. Are they getting it? We've been baptized into Jesus Christ. And some of us have been confirmed into Jesus Christ. And some of us have been ordained. And some of us have been married. And some of us have been anointed with the sacrament of the sick. And most of us have been here for Eucharist and reconciliation. But are we getting yet? Are we getting yet? Is it just, once again, the check box? Or are we saying, yeah, there's more to my life than being right? How am I following Jesus? And where is Jesus in my life? We've got to constantly be asking ourselves that, just as we do in any relationship. But there's always, you know, we have these little checkpoints. Today's Father's Day. We honor fathers. Last month we honored mother. We have checkpoints. We have Thanksgiving Day. We have the 4th of July. We have checkpoints. The scripture is a checkpoint for us. Who do we say Jesus is in my life? And how have I lived that this past week, this past month, this past year? Not how I should, but how did I? And has there been in that process an evolving of taking up my daily cross, which is dying to myself, dying to my pride, dying to being right, dying to my way, and follow Jesus? And that's a lifelong journey. It doesn't get done in 1 week or 1 month or 1 year. It's something that has to always, always be the question. You know, where am I at? We have the gifts of the Spirit to give us the barometer so that we get an indication of whether or not we're heading in the right directions. If we have a life that's joyful, it's probably pretty assured that we're doing it in the right way. Not joyful because we can have this or have that or go here or go there, but these are things that come from the inside. The stuff on the outside doesn't count because it's like the moths come and eat it and it burns down and all that other stuff. It's got to come, the joy's got to come from the inside. The inside. So if we feel that joy inside, then we really don't get too concerned about what's out here, whether I put this basket over there or put it over there. Doesn't really make a lot of difference. If we're following Jesus and dying to ourselves, then we should have a sense of patience. Not that we're going to hold the door for somebody, but patience inside, knowing that, well, yeah, that's exactly not what I would do, but, you know, I don't live their life. I live my life. And so I'm going to do what I know I need to do. We have the inside, the spirit of a sense of generosity, knowing that our life has been freely given to us. And so we need to be able to share it. Share it with somebody else. That maybe we can do something that doesn't have to benefit us, but that could benefit someone else. Realizing that it is God's plan and He gives us different gifts and talents so that we are able to give them to one another to help the body of Christ. And when we do that, then it's not so much how much can I get or am I, you know, somewhere in the bell curve, but it's because I have been blessed, how can I in turn bless? Comes from the inside. That's the challenge of the scripture. That's the challenge, you know, we think, you know, like, well, why does God allow all this stuff to happen? Well, the world is there and God's in control of it. But all of us are in a different space, at a different time, in a different realization of recognizing that the kingdom is at hand. God's not worried about what's going on because God has it. We need to be the ones that have the sense of being able to trust God, knowing that God has us too, if we're willing to allow Him to do that. And the way we allow Him to do that is to die to ourselves and follow Jesus, to die to our way and live in love. And living in love means dying to our pride and our ego. And nobody's finished. Everybody's in a different spot. But the spot that we're in needs to be examined. And as Jesus began the gospel in prayer, all of us need to pray about it as well.